across the board. And every year lies somewhere on this risk spectrum when an area 1080 operation happens. I'm going to try and convince you that the more humans that are around and the more human peer interaction that's going on, the greater the risk. And that actually most Kia are at the safe end of the spectrum, because most Kia aren't involved in these types of interactions. And therefore we should make town forums possible. And I think this is going to be a good challenge, given what we've heard about tourism numbers and seen with tourism numbers increasing. There's been a message about not feeding the Kia, and in a lot of places it's really worked very well, like in Kahurangi, National Park, where I've hung out a bit. There's actually very few hut kia around. It used to be that every hut had a hut kia that would come and eat, scavenge from the open rubbish pits and that kind of thing. But they're a rare thing now, Kahurangi, and there's very little interaction. Before we do this, I just want to touch briefly on 1080 operations and what they look like, just because I'm sure some of you have never seen one and don't really see the maps or know what they really are. As far as you might hear the word spray and think that we're going out spraying liquid 1080 all over the forest. Not the case. They're actually very carefully orchestrated and carefully designed things. In Kahurangi, they look like this. Or at least this is what they've looked like for the last two times this sort of shaded hatchery area is the area where 1080 bait's been zoned, getting quite large. That's roughly what we did in 2014 and again in 2016. It's missing some bits, and if you know the area, you'll probably spot them. Around about 300,000 hectare area. And if we zoom in on our Wangapeka study area, this is what they look like close up. So those yellow dots are our PDS again. And you can see these parallel lines, and that's where the helicopters have flown with their underslung bucket flying and spreading the bait and the spinner out to the sides. And these days they're flying around about 180 metres apart and throwing bait either side. And we try to get really good coverage, so there's careful calibration of how far the bait goes done on airstrips and paddocks before they go out there, so that we can decide how far apart to fly the helicopters. And they're flown with GPS very precisely. They are pre-fed with non-toxic pellets these days, so before we do the poison baiting, and we aim for about 2 weeks beforehand to go out, and so non-toxic pellets. And these are cereal pellets, so they're like a big chook pellet. They're about the size these days of about the sort of the top inch of my finger, maybe not everybody else's, but they weigh about, we've got two sizes that we use, but they're either 6 grams or 12 grams. And so when we sow them at around about, we sow them at about 200 pellets per hectare. And so actually when you go out and have a look, that's, I should have worked out how many on a tennis court or something, but I didn't, but it's not very many, they're actually, And they're a pulse of control, so they're a one chance to do a good job. It's not like you're going out and doing it every 2 weeks or even every year. It's a pulse of control. They usually happen 2, 3, 4 years apart, and these days it depends on the masting and seeding of the forests. It used to be that they just happened on a regular cycle, and it was all about possums, but these days we're getting a bit clever at actually controlling the whole suite of pests with the 1080 operations, and actually getting bigger to make them last, because it's a pulse, you're immediately subject to re-invasion, and so you've got to do everything you can when you get the chance to make it last a long time. And the best way to do that is to get really good coverage and to make it really big and to utilise the natural boundaries that you might have available, such as this operation in Okarito, the pink area, in 2011, which was actually only about 30,000 hectares, but with the sea on one side and the mountains on the other, probably equivalent to a much bigger operation in the middle of the forest. And now I've mentioned timing and masting, and so I'll quickly skip through this little schematic of what happens in these masting forests, which Kia habitat is essentially masting forest. It's either dominated by beech trees, which are strongly mast seeding, or by riwu trees, which are strongly mast seeding as well. And both of these species generate, when there's a mast, They generate an increase in rodents, which may be either rats or mice or both, depending pretty much entirely on what you have there at the start. And a lot of what you have there at the start depends on what altitude you're at and what kind of forest you've got. But up here, where we're really quite high and it's pretty much mountain beech forest, these rodent eruptions tend to be mice. As you go further down the hill and get more red beech forest and or rimu forest, then these rodent eruptions become more about rats. The mast provides a window of opportunity of about a year. So flowering occurs, this is for beech trees, flowering occurs 1 November. And the seed is available for rodents through till the following November, by which time it's pretty much there's a reasonably mass germination event. And if you walk around in the October, November of the last year, looking at the forest floor, you'll find little carpets of little seedlings that are just germinated. And at that point, all this energy is no longer available for rodents. And they stop breeding, and they flatline. So we've got this flatline phase here that persists into the post-mast year, and then crash in the middle of the post-mast year when winter comes on with no seed around, and it becomes no good for the rodents again. The stoats only breed once a year. We've got to keep that clear in our mind. Every year at about Christmas, we get this pulses of baby stoats into the system. And when there's been lots of rodents in the forest through the winter, that pulse is a particularly big pulse. It's an injection that each female stoat can have double figures worth of kits in a stoat plague year if they've had after a rodent year. And I think 15 is the biggest number I've heard. 15 at once. And so it all starts, and then you've got a stoat plague year. This is all very simplified, so you know we don't really know how long the stoat plague year lasts, but we know it's bad. And this breeding season here for Kia, which is the following spring at the end of the stoat plague year, so this is a whole year after the last year, is the worst one. That's when Kia really struggle to get chicks away, and we start losing some adults to stoat predation as well.
Can you show that again?
Can I say that again?
Yes.
No, I haven't got time. I'll say it again later. The stoat plague year is the bad year for Kia. So the mast year itself isn't so bad. It's the stoat plague year that follows. That's the bad year.
Year up.
So in 2014, there was a great big mast right across the country. Arthur Cast got a massive plague of mice. 2015 was the bad year. So there were no young kia produced in these mountains in that 2015 breeding season, and hence in 2016 there's no young kia around. And so it's complete recruitment failure for a year, or production failure for a year. So the 2014 aerial 1080 program looked a bit like this. So you can see the green again is that kia distribution, and then there's these little blue polygons are our 1080 drops that we did in 2014. So Kahurangi is quite outstanding in terms of the area that we did. And Maruia was quite big, but then we're getting into, these ones aren't too bad, but they're still right down at the 30,000 hectare end of the spectrum, which is what we used to think was big, but actually we need to get bigger, and getting bigger is working, and there's equipment to get bigger. So it's still only just sort of, most of these here are not subject to 1080 drops in way, shape or form, but we're growing it. Right, but what about the ones that eat 1080 bait? Well, let's have a look at our data set then. So we've now monitored Kia using our radio tags through 19 1080 operations since 2008 with varying sample sizes. So some of these sample sizes are actually a concerted effort. This is the number of Kia we've monitored. Concerted effort to catch and tag Kia specifically to get a measure of how they go through the 1080 drop. In some places it's really hard work, and we noticed in the course of trying to catch these kia that when you go out into the backcountry and try to catch kia, you can put cheese out, or you can put, they don't care. They'll walk past the cheese and pull up a silmizia and eat it. They're different beasts. Whereas if you go up here onto the tops, they'll come straight over and you can 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 34 in the Otira. And that was put together pretty quickly, compared with the same amount of effort, probably, that it took us to get 13 up on around Mount Arthur. So anyway, the main places where we've got problems, as far as I know, where Kia really interact a lot with people, with Arthur's Pass, Glacier Country, and the Milford Road and Milford Track. There's a lot of it. You can drive along the Milford Road, there's thousands of people going through every day, and bus drivers will be stopping and actually feeding here in the city. Tourists get a good buzz out of it. Just because we haven't actually been doing much to make sure that this is a happening. But we really need to up the ante on that. Those are the three main places, and most of the rest of the people in the country are not involved in this kind of stuff. There's some secondary places, a bunch of great walks, and I think these are places that we need to watch. The Heathy Track through here has been opened up to mountain biking in the winter, and we're starting to see hutiers come into the huts on the Heathy Track in the winter now. And so we've got to be quite proactive. He's the one who has to sort of drive us, the dock managers of these kinds of places really need to be getting behind this a message that we need to be stopping this kind of stuff. And it may not necessarily, in addition to the habits that these young care develop of just exploring everything rather than just sticking to their natural food, there's potentially the lead chewing habit that happens in town may actually push them towards that risky end of the spectrum as well. Because I think if you're carrying some lead will set your natural caution and your behaviour changes and you become stupid. Steve Fields too.
The Kiwis getting smarter up with let out
petrol. So we keep doing 1080 drops in New Zealand on the basis that that the benefit outweighs the cost. And in the remote areas, we're here at the safe end of the spectrum, the cost is very low, the benefit's very high, and it's a no-brainer. We're actually seeing lots of care turning up around Kahuranga National Park at the moment. My key message here is that we can make all of these 1080 operations safer, all of these care safer, just by not feeding them, keeping the for them.
Thanks, Josh. I'm sorry to be here.